Can you guys see the slide? Share here, let me think. That's our. Okay, guys. So I will refer to the chat. I'm louder, please. Can you hear me? Yes, doctor. Okay, thank you very much. So this. Okay. Cancer. Okay, thank you. Here. Okay. Energy resource. There's a claim about the solar radiation or related to the solar. Profit go for the geothermal related to the heat in the side of the earth with tidal energy related to the wave ocean kind of in the solar energy the solar radiation they claim can be divided into the two types or three types of indirect solar energy. Direct solar energy, direct solar energy, and stored solar energy. And also energy resource, clearly the nuclear energy, which is we will try to look after this specific energy. Direct solar energy, normally they claim it's use of photovoltaic or solar panel. But for the normal people, they call it solar panel. But we, as a student in the RES, renewable energy system, we should call that solar panel is a photovoltaic. For the layman, for the public, they may call solar panel, but for us, since we are already in the subject of the renewable energy, we may call that kind of that flat plate is the photovoltaic. And another source of energy from the sun ray. We go for the thermal, this one, thermal, or solar thermal collector. And the photovoltaic, or for the layman, is for the public, the society, or for those who are not in this subject, we call it photovoltaic. It's a direct conversion from the sunlight into electricity. Okay. It's a very straightforward to convert the energy from the sunlight, sun ray, to become electricity. So this is the sample of solar energy technology in Malaysia. Photovoltaic can be divided into two types, either standalone. Standalone means that it's not depends on the grid or the TNB grid. They just provide with the battery. Normally, they will provide with the battery for the standalone system, or they will call it in the form of the OGPV, off-grid photovoltaic. And the another one they call is grid connected or GCPV, grid connected photovoltaic. They use the grid from the government, I mean for the from the outside, from the TNB, Tenaga Nasional Berhad, to support the system. And also they have also the hybrid system, which is the combination of the standalone and grid connected system. Okay, so this diagram referring to the solar thermal. Okay, solar thermal, which is they receive the heat. Sorry, they receive from the sunlight to trap the heat, and the heat will be convert or to be circulate into the useful heat. So these are two different things from the solar energy, which is solar energy. One thing can can change the from the sun ray become electricity, and also from the sun ray become the useful heat. So there's a two major output from the sun ray. Okay, so this is the thing. Still go for the useful heat. They go for the drying. They go for the solar hot water system. They go for the solar space heating, solar desalination, pumping, and etc. Okay, so that is the application related to the solar thermal collector or solar thermal. So this is the Malaysian climate condition throughout the months. Okay, so we can see not all in Malaysia experience high irradiance or high sun ray intensity. Okay, so you can see in the range of monthly average solar irradiance 4,000 if our what our per meter square. Sunshine in our country fortunately blessed up to 4 to 8 hours, which is a good thing to implement the solar energy. Okay, experience more than 170 rainy days. Ambient in the range of 32, relative humidity is quite high, 80 to 90. Okay, and never fall below 60. And average wind speed in the range of 2 until 9 meter per second. So by having this kind of situation, so Malaysia is the country located at the equator or Khatulistiwa or in the equator, which blessed with the sun ray quite for a long time compared to other country which is more northern or more southern from the equator. Okay, so by having the kind of advantages, so we should try to exploit the advantages to become our advantages by producing the necessarily energy or output for the sake of the good of country specifically. Khalid, are you around? Khalid and Giat? Khalid? Can I know in Sudan, what is the average ambient temperature? Okay, you will ask through what chat. Okay, can I have a look? We'll check the chat. In Sudan, Khalid, what is the average ambient temperature for Sudan? Thirty-seven to 45 degree. Okay, it's quite hot. Huh? Okay. How about Yemen? Are you around yet? So okay, for the country who experience the 37 and 45 degree C, it might be recommended to apply the solar thermal application, which is able to produce the useful heat. Okay, for the Jiat at the Yemen, so in the range of 15 to 28, it's a quite cool at first, but then it depends on the season, right, Jay? But then in the range of the 15 to 28, it still have the potential to use the solar photovoltaic because they will get the minimum losses due to the temperature effect. Okay, we will see detail what is the meaning of the temperature effect afterward during the solar explanation. Thank you, G and Khalid, for your response. Okay, so next, okay, so this is the basic, I would say basic, standalone or OGPV. I will check this one what you press for again. OGPV. Okay. OGPV. I will also check on the column OGPV of grid. off-grid photovoltaic. So normally PV, we put in the short form PV, photovoltaic. Okay, so OGPV, off-grid photovoltaic. So of course, like Sir mentioned just now, off-grid photovoltaic will consist of battery, which is this the battery. Okay, so basically this the PV. Okay, PV. PV by default produce. Okay, let's say this the sun ray. Go to the PV. PV will produce the DC current, direct current. Okay, and then they will enter the inverter. Inverter for the case of converting from the DC to the AC, because AC is the most power appliances form. For example, our lamp at our house in Malaysia is in AC, TV in AC, radio in AC. So that's why we need to convert from the DC power, from the power panel to the AC by having this kind of device, which is we call inverter. So let's say the PV produce the excessive heat, excessive power by the daytime, the remaining power will be stored in the battery. So in other words, during the night time, okay, the battery will be used to power all the AC appliances. Knowing that the battery also in the form of the DC, so they still through the inverter to convert from the DC to AC. Okay, so that's basically how it's work. And some of the another approach, they will go directly to the battery, regardless of daytime or nighttime. Okay, the battery will give all the power from DC to the AC to the appliances, and at the same time during daytime, the PV will top up the DC current to the battery. Okay, so that they will go for the good level of the battery. So we need to concern that. We need to have some sort of the design, which is to ensure that the battery can cope this kind of load. And at the same time, the PV also can support the charging to the battery to ensure that all the system can be run continuously. Okay. So far, any question related to the basic solar system? Okay, so proceed. Along the way, you may ask by referring to the chatting box. Maaf lambat. Okay, no problem. So far, clear. Okay, thank you, Wazli. Okay, so continue. So we will go this way, very slow and steady, because I think certain that it's a good way to give this kind of exposure and understanding in a peaceful manner. Instead, we are speeding the slide, everything, but you are not getting at all anything related to the things. So we will go, it's very slowly. So it doesn't matter how long it will take to settle down the slide, but then the most important part, you understand what we are trying to say. Okay, so this is another arrangement which Sir mentioned just now, the GCPV. GCPV. So remember that GCPV are related to the grid connected, which is in this case, this is the grid connected, or that the TNB resource. Okay, Tenaga Nasional Berhad. For G and GET, TNB, I'll put here. TNB refer to the tenaga TNB, Nasional Berhad. Okay, that TNB G or Kadet, that is the government, the owner of the electricity in Malaysia. I would say It's a very direct, straightforward, you know, straightforward translation. The owner of the electricity grid in Malaysia, the TNB. Okay, so what we have done from the solar panel, let's say we install the solar panel, or in other words, we install the photovoltaic panel, and then with the same lot of DC or AC, okay, DC or DC. In this case, they go for the AC, okay, mostly in our country. Yes, correct. It's a penanjung. Okay, correct. Because in Sabah or Sarawak, they have another electricity provider. Okay, Sarawak Energy, right? Okay, thank you. Okay, Peninsula Malaysia. Okay, Sabah, Sabah, what? Apa nama dia? SSB eh? Sabah. Okay, so the different, the obvious difference between GCPV and OGPV, GCPV or grid connector, they connect the inverter to the grid. In other words, the word is like this. The grid will support all your appliances, all your electrical appliances in a AC load, okay? But at the certain time, the PV also produce the energy to pump to the grid, okay? So let's say your load use is 5 kilowatt from the grid, and then your solar panel or photovoltaic panel produce 1 kilowatt. So the offset from 5 kilowatt minus 1 kilowatt is 4 kilowatt. So that you need to pay only 4 kilowatt to the TNB grid or to the electric provider. Okay, so that's the basic thing. So that is how it's work related to the GCPV. Okay. So, anyone want to install the GCPV? Okay. It will cost you, for now, it will cost you, I would say, 6,000. 6,000, if you can afford that. But it will, it depends on how much you consume for your monthly bills. Okay, let's say you are only go for, let's say, less than 100 ringgit. So that's not recommended for you guys to install the GCPV system. So if I'm not mistaken, based on the recent statement, if your billing at your house or your organization up to 400 ringgit. Okay, let's say you have a bungalow. Okay, also at the kitchen also have the aircon. Kan? Also at the washroom, every aircon, everything aircon. So, and it exceeds more than 400 ringgit per month. So it's suggested or recommended to install the GCPV so that you can get the utmost benefit or advantages related to the installation of the GCPV. Okay. Okay, some of the people also try to combine the wind power, a diesel generator, and hydro. Okay, so because they claim that PV only give you the sun ray during the daytime, right? So what happened to the night? So by having that kind of issue, they try to impose the wind power. So wind power, as long as you manage to get wind, either during the daytime or during the night time or evening time, whatever time, during your sleep time, you still manage to generate, to produce the electricity to store in your battery. So that's the idea of having the wind power. But also it depends where is your location is. Let's say you are surrounding with the blockage building and everything, it will be not practical to install the wind power. Or else you are staying somewhere in the open space like the at the beach or something like that. Okay? that there's also it might be recommended to have the wind power in at your specific places. Related to the diesel generator, normally they will go for the backup to ensure your system work consistently. Okay, because diesel, normally they will go for panel first, and let's say for the photovoltaic panel is insufficient or reduced, they will start to trigger the diesel generator to start the generator to produce electricity. Okay. Same goes to the hydro, with the same cases of the wind power. Okay, as long the dedicated area you are selected to install the hydro have the flow to the downstream to enter the hydro system, so you will go to generate the power continuously. But then the issue is how many people can stay at the house nearby with the source of river, source of hydro, okay? How many people or residential that can stay or can be located at the area which open space with the wind power. So that's why there is a certain issue we need to consider or we need to solve the problem. Okay, so just to mention that the player of the manufacturer of the solar power, for the photovoltaic module. Okay, so top, my name is Sharp, Kyocera, BP Solar, Isophoton, Sanyo, Qcell, Astro Power. Some of the manufacturer is not. Okay, so. Yeah, this is the one of the, sorry, 10 of the manufacturer in Malaysia. Can you guys specify at least one EV manufacturer in Malaysia, photovoltaic manufacturer in Malaysia? Anyone can try your luck. At least one manufacturer in Malaysia of solar module or PV module. Anyone? Then top manufacturer. You can go in Melaka itself. You can go for the Sun Power somewhere in Alu Gajah. If I'm not mistaken, they are the manufacturer of the photovoltaic module in Melaka specifically. Okay. So you may go for the others. So this is the sample of the standalone. Okay. Normally they will call that those who are installed the PV is the rich people, right? Rich people, yeah? Or educated people, rich people, or whatever status of the people. But then actually the standalone system, it already installed to the perkampungan orang asli, which is they do not have the grid, which is maybe in the rural area. It will costly, very expensive, maybe at a hill area or something. So the most solution, they will go for the installing the OGPV, off grid photovoltaic. So this is the off-grid photovoltaic. Okay. So it solves the electricity for the dedicated house. So we also can try to install the EV then. Okay. For the street, or for the those who have the land to be plantation, but the grid cannot enter the site, so they try to go for the standalone system to produce the electricity to share with the farmer or something. Okay, this also inside the village was probably not available of the grid connected. So that's why they go for the off-grid connected. Same goes here. Okay. So normally they go for the rural area that have the issue or problem to install the grid. So they go for the standalone system or OGPP. Okay. It connected capacity for 100 kilowatt peak, kilowatt peak holding the holding the connected PV. So some of it install the PV like this. Okay, but some of the residential or domestic people, they put this PV and put on the roof. Okay, on the roof. So depends on the application. So okay, so this is the sample of the on the roof. They say you have your bungalow, and then you have that enough space to place your PV, so you can put your PV on the roof, so that you can get, you do not have to bear additional area or racking to mounting your PV. You can just place on your rooftop to ensure that you can get the maximum irradiance. But you need to ensure that there's not any blockage surrounding to your roofing to get the maximized power from the PV generator. Okay, so this is another one, installing the PV, okay, on the roof. So they also call this one BIPV, Building Integrated Photovoltaic. So BIPV, okay, BIPV. This term, BIPV, building BIPV. Okay. But some cases they go for the BIPV. Okay, building integrated photovoltaic. Okay. So far so good, everybody. So far so good. Okay. So this is the more extreme. So previously we just show the case of residential or domestic, but this time around we go for the commercial building. So they implement on the rooftop of their building, and they need, of course, they need to sizing. What is the optimum? What is the right configuration so that they can manage to get the desired output? But normally, I would say they will go for the maximize the rooftop for install the solar PV. They say they will gain. They say they will gain for this case 400 kilowatt peak. So then they will use the power that generated by the PV, and the remaining that they will top up with the GNB, with the grid to support the consumption of the electricity for the dedicated building or organization. Okay, so do not worry. Let's say you have the company and everything, you can go for develop the building first, and then when you have the good revenue throughout the years, then you can try to spend your expenditure of the company by investing to the solar energy as a part of your main resource of electricity. Okay, there's not necessarily to build the building at one go with the solar system. You can go it stagingly. Firstly, try to set up your building first, and then after you get the revenue, etc., try to looking for the potential of the installing the photovoltaic as a part of your renewable energy or electrical energy resource. Okay, so no problem. Okay, so this is another way installing the PV. Okay. So normally this one you go for the at the roof, at the roof with the railing and everything. So yeah, most of the people start to do this, especially on the parking site or parking area, because normally in the parking area, of course, they will develop the roof to avoid your car or your vehicle from the sun ray. And then by having that roof that exposed to the sun ray, they implement to put the solar or photovoltaic to gain the electricity. So this is the sample of the photovoltaic module installation on the roof. Okay, so this one on the fuel station. The house. So the house, normal house, typical house. Okay, and then also they save that have the box. So if you still remember, beside the photovoltaic, we also have the inverter, all the connection and all the safety device, which is can be stored or installed in the separate compartment at the house. Okay, so do not put everything this kind of device, such as inverter, the circuit breaker, to on the roof. They will go specifically on the dedicated cabinet or compartment to install the device. Okay, only the PV on the top of the roof, the rest can be installed at the ground level to for the monitoring basis on the system. Okay, so as simple as that. So, okay, so this is the thing that Sir mentioned just now. They place the PV on the roof of parking. Okay, so that of course they can get the maximized irradiance because the exposure of the sun ray directly. Okay, so that's the one of the strategy. Okay, so also they go for the this one is the solar car, I mean solar race car. So this one, they go for the competition to see how long it can go by having all the PV on the car, on the solar car. Okay, this one is a competition at the competition among other country. So for UTEM, we never go this event because at that time the knowledge of the solar energy is not that exposed good or that much to the management perhaps. So of course related to the budget, which costs very high, because normally they will conduct this event outside from Malaysia. So of course the expenditure and the cost quite high to support this event, but it's a good exercise then to implement the thing you learn from the in the class and to try to be implement on the solar car and try to race with the others country or others university and see how it goes the result. Okay. Okay, so this is the another one of the solar panel that combined with the weather station to power the power station. Okay, solar phone, solar cell phone. Okay. The at the maritime parts, okay, to power the light at the for the monitoring basis safety. Okay, so this is the exhibition related to the PV. Okay, so basically potential for solar hot Next, we go for the solar thermal. Previously, we go for the PV or photovoltaic, which is related to the general electricity. It can be in the form of the GCPV, or it can be in the form of the OGPV. So this time around, we will go for the solar thermal collector that specifically to produce the useful heat. The useful heat can be the form of the water or air. Okay, so depends on the application. If you want to go for the air, normally it will go for the industry, or you go for the section or sector that relates to the drying sector. Okay, due to the hot air to drying sector. But for the hot water, for hot water, normally it will goes to the domestic or industry or commercial building that need or require the hot water. Okay, for example, for domestic, maybe we want the hot water for the bath or for the dishwasher, perhaps. But for the industry, maybe they go for the hotel, for example, they will go for the hot shower, maybe, or for the kitchen, hot water for the kitchen. So that kind of application might be different based on the range of the water produced by the certain application. Okay, but the big idea is a very straightforward. Most of the industry, regardless of domestic or until the factory or other manufacturer, they will need the useful heat to produce as a part of the saving energy. Okay, so let's say for this part, essentially electricity consumer. Okay, so the dwelling house and maybe so this is the electricity. Okay, kampung house, palace or palace 150. Just go for this. This is the section. Okay, so it approximately 10 meters square. Are suitable for solar thermal collector to be okay. So potential for solar heating system in Malaysia. So those any building or any mall that need or require the hot water, I can try to implement the solar thermal collector. So the idea is very straightforward. Let's say you want to produce the hot water in the range of the 60 degrees C for your, let's say, for whatever application in your industry. Okay, and the normal tap from the tap give you 30 degrees C. So you need to have the operation or heating element for electricity delta T or equal to the 30 degrees C. But by having the solar collector or solar thermal collector, maybe you can improve from the 30 from the solar tap from the tap to become, let's say, 50 degrees C. So you need only the cost of billing or electric consumption of heating another 10 degrees C to achieve that 60 degrees C. So yet you already save up to the 20 degrees C by free energy resource by applying the solar thermal collector in your organization, and yet you need just to pay the bills, which is on the heater part, heating element, which is 10 degrees C from 50 degrees C to the 60 degrees C. So that's the basic idea, the implementation of the solar thermal collector. Okay, so we go for the, you will say, we go for the preheating first. Then you try to top up the remaining or the required temperature that you want to do for your operation, so that it can save you a lot of energy by having the preliminary heating before you proceed for your desired temperature. Okay, so we can faculty, hostel, kitchen, whichever place that required the solar thermal application. Okay, potential solar information. So this is the type of the solar collector. So if you can see this one, there's a few types of the solar thermal collector. It can be in the form of the unglazed, glazed, and evacuated tube. Okay, so these three types give you different efficiency, and of course, the highest efficiency is the evacuated tube, and the second one is the glazed, and the last one is the unglazed. Okay, so why the unglazed not good as glazed? Because the glaze is present with the glaze, glass, okay, which is able to trap the heat better compared to the unglazed, because the unglazed solar collector experience high losses on the top surface of the solar collector. So that's why the efficiency of the unglazed are slightly lower compared to the glaze. Okay, so that's the. So if you can see from here, Australia is the most, Australia and also the US, United States. Okay, I mean the player related to the solar water collector, okay, either unglazed, glazed, or evacuated tube. Okay, so of course, this kind of unglazed, glazed, and evacuated tube give you the different cost for each, which is the evacuated tube is relatively high or expensive compared to the glazed and unglazed. Okay, what's this? Considering only the lower 0.7 kilowatt per square multiplier. Okay, so this is the estimated power that generated by the roofing area, okay, by the available building surface. So, okay, another potential for solar water heating element at the hospital, because I think most of the hospital need the hot water, just a matter of how greasy the hot water you want to produce. Okay, so as I said just now, we can produce the hot water, but then you only need the top up of the additional heating element until the mid of the requirement of the operation. Okay, for example, before one in this area is a open space, and then they install the solar collector or PV, or solar collector or PV, or to produce the hot water. So by having that kind of arrangement, they can produce the preliminary hot water before they increase the temperature for the desired requirement. Okay, okay, so this one, payback, less than 4 years, 100 hospital and business, opportunity of 200 million. So that's the potential for the solar. Okay, so previously we just mentioned the application of the solar thermal related to the useful heat in the form of water. So this time around, we go for the application of the solar thermal for the useful heat in the form of the air for the drying or agriculture produce. Okay, so of course, in general, the use of the hot air for the space heating or to the drying purposes, specifically for the agriculture product. Okay, of course, we know that the certain commodity have their own dedicated moisture content, so we need to be very careful to apply the space heating or to apply the drying using the resource also for the useful heat, because each commodity, let's say the paddy, cocoa, coffee, paper, have their own moisture content. So it will take some time to ensure that it meet the desire or the quality that we need. Compared to the traditional way, they go for the open drying on the floor, maybe on the racking. They will go, will take some time, let's say 5 to 6 hours, okay, and then go for the cocoa 6 days, almost a week, to get the clean, sorry, to get the dried cocoa, coffee for the almost 2 weeks, and paper 7 days. Okay, so most of the time they will spend a lot of hours and daytime to ensure that they can dry all the agricultural product accordingly. So by implementing the okay, so this is the time, okay, tobacco, tea, banana, rubber, everything. Okay. So by implementing the I would say the chamber of the drying, okay, with the setup of the desired temperature or the hot air, so they will try to decrease the duration of the drying rate or drying time from the conventional arrangement or conventional open sun drying. Okay, so by placing on the roof the solar turbine and in this chamber or in this room, which is enclosed with the with the product, with the agriculture product, they will produce the hot air inside here and try to dry up until the limit of the moisture that we allow for the next processor. Okay, so this is how it goes or how it's work. Okay, so this is the how it's look. Maybe it can be implemented in the Sudan, because you have the you blessed with the high temperature of your country, so that maybe you can make use of it for the application in the drying system application. Okay, so this is the basic thing. Okay, so this is the air inlet go inside the collector. Okay, and at the same time it will collect, you collect the hot air to become the useful heat of air. Okay, and then in the air, okay, and then go to surround all the tray inside the chamber, and then go outside to the atmosphere, and the circulation will be continuous run until it stops with the desired moisture content of the dedicated product. Normally, they will go each tray in the chamber for the same type of product, because of course every product have their own moisture content. So by having, by implementing the same product, we'll get the same or at least the better uniformity in terms of the drying parts. Yeah. So this is the another one of the sample of the drying chamber. So on the top of this, on the roof, is the solar collector, solar thermal collector. They will absorb all the heat from the sun ray, and then go inside this chamber. Sorry, go this one. Okay, okay. Go to this one. This one is the chamber. Go this one. So this one is the pipe line. Go from the underneath of the drying chamber, because we know that the hot air by buoyancy effect will go upstream by its own. So by putting the heat source from the tube underneath the drying chamber, it will go by itself towards the upward and yet go to the outside to the ambient. So that hot air that collected from this roof and insert to this channel and go to the disconduit will go to dry the agriculture product in this chamber, placing with every single layer have their own tray, and yet go to the atmosphere, and the circulation will be continuously until stop to the desired motion quantum. Because you need to know if the product or aggregation product is overdrive, it will cause you the reject first. Firstly, it's a reject. And in terms of the quality itself, I mean the structure and everything. So you need to be careful on that to ensure that you are producing just sufficient enough for the desired or dedicated motion content. Instead of you go for overdrive, which is will be rejected or will be have the rejected, I would say the rejected line due to the quality effect, due to the quality effect of the product. So this is how it goes. Another view of the solar thermal application. Okay, so sometimes they put also the V-groove collector just to increase the efficiency of the collecting the hot air, because the V-groove refer to the you adding the more area in channel to be absorbed on the V-groove to be transmit to the product. Okay, so that's the one of the way how to increase the heat gain through the glass cover by increasing the area by placing the V groove collector in the tube channel. Okay, so that's the thing. So this is the collector. This is the collector. And then we just go inside there. And then we'll go for the standard circulation of the hot air. No problem. So very basic. So you just imagine this car. So it 1980 car. So in other words, it show you the technology is already there for quite some times. Just the matter, maybe the exposure from the public or the society to implement this kind of technology is not that spread to the others. So you guys already take this kind of class. I'm expecting you are the one who will be promote this kind of approach for your own, maybe for your own application or maybe for your industry or your organization, perhaps. Okay, so this is the another style of solar thermal collector. So I believe this one is the solar thermal collector. This one is the chamber that connect the hot air inside this room. Okay, so this is the detail. So what I'm trying to show you, this the 9 is the chamber. They put the product or aggregation product by layer. Okay, so by layer. So as I mentioned just now, they will go the hot water from the 13, this one, hot air from the underneath of the chamber, and then they try to dry up the things. Okay, they try to dry up the things. Okay, so the rest is just the matter of the system that support for the drying activity. Okay, so this is another one related to the system. So normally they will go this one or for the, I would say the SME, small manufacturing enterprise or medium manufacturing enterprise. Okay. So this is the test related to the solar drying system. They have this light as indoor solar simulator just to give the as a mimic for the sunray to check whether the system is working with the desired output that they set for this drying chamber. Okay, so this halogen lamp will attach to the this top roofing area. Sorry, this top drain chamber, and then generate the hot air inside here, and then go for the this channel. Okay, So this kind of arrangement. So of course, we already relate to the store solar energy, renewable energy hydrocarbon, and renewable energy hydrocarbon. Okay. So now remaining hydrocarbon, coal, natural gas, shale, and petroleum. Renewable energy, hydrocarbon. So oil palm waste, forest residue, urban waste, rice husk, and biogas. So this one is related to the biomass, which is we will cover later on. Just go for this one. So, okay, I think we go this one. Just give you the idea. So before we enter the biomass, any question from all of you related to the solar photovoltaic and also the solar thermal collector? Solar photovoltaic consists of two main system, which is the OGPV then GCPV. And the solar thermal collector produce two type of the useful heat, which is useful heat in the form of the air, which for the space heating and for the drying, and useful heat in the form of water for the hot to produce the hot water for the dedicated hot water application. So that's the basic idea. What is the solar energy?